Would you perform wonders that cannot be counted? Miracles that can't be counted. Would you perform wonders that cannot be fathomed? Miracles that can't be counted. Would you perform wonders that cannot be fathomed? Miracles that can't be counted. Would you perform wonders that cannot be fathomed? Miracles that can't be counted. Wonders that cannot be fathomed. Miracles that can't be counted. Would you perform wonders that cannot be fathomed? Miracles that can't be counted. Would you perform wonders that cannot be fathomed? Miracles that can't be counted. Everlasting, everlasting, everlasting God. Oh,
and they're holding on to me. Holding on.
Oh, this love, this love. Oh, this love of God beyond compare. So far beyond compare. Oh, your love, oh Lord. Your arms so wide, they hold the sky. Your arms so wide, the universe inside. With your arms so wide, they hold the skies. With your arms so wide, they hold the universe inside. With your arms so wide, they hold the skies. With your arms so wide, the universe inside. And you're holding on, holding on to me. You're 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 holding on to me. Oh, this love, this love. Oh, this love beyond compare. This love, oh, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love, oh, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love, oh, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love, oh, this love. This love beyond compare. Oh, the love of God, how rich, how sure, how measureless and strong your love. Oh, the love of God, how rich, how sure, how measureless and strong this love. Oh, the love of God, how rich, how sure, how measureless and strong this love. Oh, the love of God, how rich, how sure, how measureless and strong your love. Oh, the love of God, how rich, how sure, how measureless and strong your love. Oh, the love of God, how rich, how sure, how measureless and strong your love. Oh, the love of God, how rich, how sure, how measureless and strong you're. And you're holding on, you're holding on. Unbreakable love, unending love, unfailing love, unfailing love, unfailing love, never ending love of God. You're holding. Oh, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love, oh, this love beyond compare. Oh, the love of God, how rich, how sure, how the love of God, how rich, how sure, how measureless and strong your love. Oh, the love of God, how rich, how sure, oh, measureless and strong your love. Oh, the love of God, how rich, how sure, how measureless and strong your love. And I will sing of your love. I will sing of your unending love. I will sing of your love forever. I will sing of your unending love. I will sing of your love forever. I will sing of your unending love, oh God. Oh Lord. I will sing of your love forever. I will sing of your unending love. I will sing of your love forever, Lord. Your unfailing love, unfailing love, unfailing love, unfailing love, unfailing love. Unfailing love, unfailing love, unfailing my soul. Your love captivates me, surrounds and invades me. Oh, unfailing love, unfailing love. That overwhelms and floods my soul with all your goodness, Lord, all your mercy, Lord, your overwhelming love. Oh, what overwhelming love. Oh, what of my Savior.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Jesus, 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 Jesus. To set to fan to con yan to con chana. Oh, Jesus, 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 Jesus. The name that every knee shall bow out and every tongue shall confess that He is Lord. He is Lord. He is Lord. Every knee, every knee, every knee ever that was created will bow and will confess that He is Lord. Oh Jesus, you are beautiful. Oh Jesus, you are lovely. Father, you are so wonderful. Father, we praise you. We glorify your name because there is none like you. There's none like you. There's none like you. There's none like you. And we praise you, Father. Oh, Father, we thank you for this fellowship, this glorious fellowship with you that is so wonderful. Oh, Father, our tongues cannot even express the glory. Oh God, our tongues cannot express, Father, how glorious your presence is. Lord Jesus, how wonderful it is to break the bread of communion with you. Oh Father, we thank you. Oh Father, we praise you, for you are wonderful. Oh glory to your name, Almighty God. Oh glory, oh glory. Oh, glory to your name, Almighty God. Masikeda Moshitara, Niankandi, Likandi, and then Kinto Koboro Sotura. Orebebe Bakune, she. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Isaiah chapter 12. And in that day, you shall say, praise the Lord. I will praise thee. Though you were angry with me, your anger is turned away, and you've comforted me. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and I'll not be afraid. For the Lord, Jehovah, is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. Hallelujah. He's become my salvation. Hallelujah. The mighty God, Jehovah. Jehovah is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Therefore with joy shall I draw waters out of the well of salvation. Amen. This relationship and this fellowship that I have with the Father through Jesus Christ the righteous is joyful, and I will joyfully draw waters continually out of the well of salvation. Put away the struggle, because there isn't one. The victory's won in us, and it's in the fellowship, and it's in the communion that it's always joy. No matter what's going on in the world around us, no matter what men try to do to us, no matter what condition we find ourselves in, what trouble, what affliction, what suffering, with joy shall we draw water out of the well of salvation. With joy, with joy, with joy, with joy shall we draw water out of the well of salvation. And in that day we shall say, praise the Lord. Call upon his name. Declare his doings among the people. Make mention that his name is exalted. Sing unto the Lord. For he has done excellent things. This is known in all the earth. Cry out, shout, thou inhabitants of Zion. For great is the Holy One. Hallelujah. For great is the Holy One of Israel. In the middle of you, in the midst of you. He's here. He's here. He's right here. Where two or three are gathered in his name, there he is. There he is. And he's come here tonight to fellowship with us. And we've come here tonight to fellowship with him. And because we've come here to fellowship with him, he's come here to fellowship with us. He's here because he loves so much. He loves so much. I love that song, and you're holding on to me. And you won't ever let me go. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, Father, so with joy, knowing that the Almighty God, the Creator of all things, has my salvation. He has my salvation. He is my salvation. And I'm staying there. I'm not going out. I'm not going anywhere. I'm staying over here. I'm staying in the glory. I'm staying in the bliss. I'm staying in heaven, days of heaven on earth. Oh, praise you, Jesus. Oh, praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Oh, he's so good. He's so good. He's so good. Joyful salvation. Glorious. So we're going to just make a joyful noise unto the Lord. We're going to sing unto the Lord. We're going to worship him in his holy hill. We're going to declare all of his greatness. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Father. You know, the enemy cannot stand in the praise when we're praising Jesus. Yeah, he was the worshiper. But when we're praising him in spirit and truth, it puts the enemy on the run. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to your name. Oh, glory to your name. Oh, glory to your name. Father, I just thank you. I thank you, Jesus, that you enable us. I like how what Paul was praying in Colossians chapter 1. You know, as I was praying last week, as I do continually on a daily basis, and I hope everybody does, and I don't see how anybody could stand to be without that fellowship and that relationship. You know, when you just take that time that you move aside away from the stuff that's going on and you get down and you're quiet. I mean, we're praying, you know, we're to pray always, continually. We're to always be in prayer and in thanksgiving and always be in that place. But when you just put everything aside and you're just there, and that's that time for you and Jesus, that's that time for you and the Father, that glory, that the way he comes down and hugs you. Do you know what I'm saying? How he just hugs you, and it is so sweet. I'm like, you just, you know, an hour of prayer is just not enough. You know, the more I pray, the more I see the need for prayer, and the more I don't want to quit praying. There is such glory in his presence, and there's such need for prayer on earth. And there's, you just can't get through enough in prayer. By the time you get done worshiping and you get done praising and you get done thanking him and then you begin to make your requests and petitions known to him, there's just so much. And then the Holy Spirit takes over, and then you get raptured over into the heavenly language. And then, you know, you're just getting to be part of whatever God's getting done by the Holy Ghost through you, because you don't understand. I know sometimes I pray in the spirit, and at the same time I'm hearing the translation. I know exactly what the Holy Ghost is praying. I hear it is. And sometimes he's taking me over and he's just praying through me, and I don't even know what's being said, but I know things are happening. And I know that continually joy bubbles up out of it. And I like it when the joy bubbles up out of it, because then I know I'm talking to the Father. Then I know I'm not over here caught up in Geneva in some struggle trying to, oh God, how are we going to do it? I know he's faithful. He's going to do it. And then I'm just going to yield myself to him. And he's going to work that by his Spirit in me and through me as I just yield myself to him. You know, just one person praying can turn things upside down. And I mean, two people praying The unity. We look at the unity in Acts chapter 2. They were there. The unity is the key there. They were there in one place, in one accord, in unity, waiting for one purpose, for the Holy Ghost to be poured out. And the Holy Ghost came and was poured out, and he's been changing the world ever since through everyone that will allow him. You look at that power and that authority that comes when you pray. There's power in prayer to turn things upside down. For God, not against him. For him. And one person praying, you know, just, you know, there's so many people you could talk about in history. You could talk about Finney or D.L. Moody or, you know, just so many you could name that, you know, they talked about, like when D.L. Moody came into town, there would be, people would be falling out. There'd be all kinds of things happening for miles around. Conviction would hit the whole town. Same thing with Finney. He'd walk into a factory, never been in there, and just look around, and people would just start falling under the power of God, under conviction for their sins. And I'm like, oh, Jesus, the power of prayer. The power of prayer. It changes the atmosphere around us. It takes authority over the atmosphere around us. And you think, you know, there's a battle, and you've got one person, and you've got 1,000 people over here. And one person can put 1,000 of the enemy to flight. One person. This is God's mathematics that we don't quite comprehend. One person can tear up 1,000 of the enemy. And you look at that in a literal army. You know, you come out, there's one person on this side and there's 1,000 on this side. That would look like, you know, this person was done. But no, this one person can put that 1,000 to flight. There's power in the name of Jesus. The enemy cannot stand against the name of Jesus. If God's people will be of one accord in one place in prayer, seeking after him, if we will push forward to do all and be all that God has given us to be, we'll tear the place up. Because the powers of darkness have their work in the atmosphere. And when we break down the atmosphere in as far as the powers of darkness, because he's the prince and the power of the air, right? You know, I need to go in some scriptures here. He's the prince and the power of the air, the spirit that works in the children of disobedience. So he's working because he's finding the people of disobedience, and so he's got authority to work in the children of disobedience. And so he's very good at convincing people to be disobedient. He's very good at his job. He's very good at pulling together his crowd of renegades. And so he works there. But when we pray, we begin to break down that authority in the atmosphere, over the region that we're in, or over the region that God could pick us up on our knees in our living room and take us over to a region in another country. And we are praying by the Spirit. We don't even know where we are in the Holy Ghost. And we're breaking down the powers of darkness. We could be praying for somebody's meetings that they're getting ready to have in a foreign country. We don't know what we're praying for. We're just given over to saying, here I am, Holy Ghost, do what you need to do. And Father needs, he needs people to pray. That's what he's commissioned us to do. That's what he's given us the authority to do in earth. He's given us that authority. We have that authority. Isn't that amazing? We have that authority, and God needs us to use it. He wants us to use it. He's looking for those that will use the authority that he's given us. And when we get to heaven, we'll know what all we got to do by the Holy Ghost. And the more we're faithful, the more we'll know what we get to do in the Holy Ghost while we're here, because he'll show us. Amen. But, I mean, we want to be those that push back the atmosphere. Amen. So then there's two that put 10,000 to flight. So that is nothing to do with any kind of math that Einstein came up with. That is just far beyond. You know, as I was talking to Jeremy about it, I said, so if one puts 1,000 to flight and two puts 10,000 to flight, because I've been thinking about this for a while, I'm just going over it. I'm like, well, so in that type of mathematics, would three put 100,000 to flight? And Jeremy goes, well, and he explains all this stuff that I'm just going, okay. And so he was telling me all this stuff, and he goes, well, it could be 300,000, or it could be three putting a million to flight. And, you know, but, you know, in the math that I'm comprehending as I'm talking to the Lord, as I'm seeing one put 1,000 to flight, two put 10,000 to flight, three put 100,000 to flight, four put a million to flight. So the enemy's got a lot of workers out there. And he works through the children of disobedience. But I'm going to tell you what, those guys are one-on-one for the most part. Now, there are some that have given themselves over to the devil and made pacts with the devil, and they have authority because they give themselves. And I'm like, God, if your people would give themselves like the enemy, like people that have allowed the enemy to take over, we could shake things up. And God wants us to shake things up. I was reading about Reinhard Bonnke in one of the meetings that he had. It just talked about how he started out. He, at 10 years old, he felt called to Africa, and he was made fun of and ridiculed, and some people encouraged him, and some people says, you're never going to go to Africa, and you just, and people, you know, Job's comforters will always come along and tell you why you don't have the ability to do what God puts in your heart to do. And a lot of people get talked out of what God put in their heart to do by, you know, well-meaning people. I don't know how well-meaning they are, but anyway. So anyway, finally at the age of 23, 24, somewhere around in there, he finally, 25 I think it was, he went to Africa. And for years, he was just out on the street with his accordion playing and singing, and he'd play and sing, and then a group would come around, and when the group come around, he'd stop playing and singing, and he would preach to the group. And he prayed for years, oh God, give me all of Africa. God calls me to impact Africa. Africa's big. There's one man on the street with an accordion, playing his accordion, singing the songs. Crowd comes around, he preaches, and he's like, God, give me all of Africa. You know, he's preaching to 10, 20, maybe 30 at a time. God, give me all of Africa. 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 Just crying out to God for all of Africa for years. And he kept playing his accordion and preaching to the 10, 20, 30. Because he was going to reach Africa one way or the other. If it was 10, 20, or 30 at a time, he was going to reach Africa. He was going after Africa. God put Africa in his heart, and he wasn't going to let up on Africa. And then one time he's out on the street and he's playing his accordion, and the Lord met him there and it said, you know, and I'm skipping a lot of parts, but the Lord said, I want you to rent the biggest hall in this area that you can rent. And then I want you to, and then after that you're going to go to the stadium. And the big stadium. And he's got 10, 20, 30 people on the street corner in the meeting. And so he talks to a church that had about 40 people, trying to get maybe some people on board, you know, some encouragement, some coming together. And they just basically said, you're crazy. Nobody's going to come. And he knew that God told him to do it. So he did it, you know, and he has no support, because who is he? He's a nobody, because they asked him first thing. They go, well, who are you? He goes, nobody. And he said, but God told me to do it, and I know God told me to do it. And they're like, yeah, right. Don't count on us. Wow, the church. And so he rented the biggest hall, advertised. A few people come out, just barely filled part of the big building. I think there was over 100 in like a 4,000 or 5,000 seater place. And he said he was a little discouraged, but he got out there and he preached just like he was preaching to thousands of people. He preached. And as he's preaching, suddenly somebody jumped up and said, I just got healed. Another person pops up. I just got healed. Another person pops up. I just got healed. I was blind. Now I can see. I was deaf. Now I can hear. It was just radical. People just popping up all over the place, healed. He'd not had healing in his meetings, but he obeyed God. He stayed faithful. He stayed faithful to what God gave him to do, regardless of what it looked like. He did not give up. He did not back down. And believe me, the enemy came out to hinder him so many times. The enemy comes out to hinder us, to try to stop us, to try to push us back, to try to keep us from advancing, to try to discourage us in what we're doing, because we start out and it may look small and it may look like it's going nowhere. And so we just go, okay, well, maybe God didn't speak. But I looked at Reinhardt, I'm just reading this, and how he just kept right on playing that accordion, and he kept on persevering and staying right there, right where God had placed him to be. And then the place the next night was jam-packed because the word went out. When blind eyes see and deaf ears open. And the rest is history as far as that goes with Reinhard Bonnke, because it continued going on. But just one more thing, you know, because the part of the message was of this testimony that I was reading was when the witch doctors tried to bring an end to Reinhard Bonnke and run that white boy out of Africa because they didn't want him there. And so at this point, you know, Reinhard Bonnke's meetings are growing, it's progressing. And so he has a tent made that will seat 35,000 people. And it takes 3 years for this tent to be made. And, you know, if you read the story, it's just miracle after miracle for him to get all of this, because he did not like to ask for money. He would never do a telethon. He would lightly mention it and just totally talk to the Lord about it, because he didn't like to ask for money. He wanted God to provide it. And God did, in just miraculous ways. So he gets the tent. They dedicate, they have a big dedication. 40,000 people come out for the dedication of the 35,000-seater tent. So they have the dedication of it, and the witch doctors come, and they're mad, and they're going to run him out of town. And, you know, of course, they're standing in prayer and, you know, believing God, and they hear the threats. And then a wind comes. And the weatherman couldn't even explain the wind. A wind comes and just shreds the tent. It's all littered all over the neighborhood. But the poles are standing, and, you know, some of the lights were still good, and the semi-trucks that cost $4 million were still intact. All of them were still intact, because it took 4 semi-trucks to transport the stuff. They were a special 4-wheel drive, and that's an amazing story how God gave them those trucks, you know, that had to be for all terrain to go throughout Africa to set up this tent. And so they're getting ready to do this big, huge meeting that they had planned that lasted for a couple of weeks, and they needed the tent and the heaters and everything because it was the cold time in Africa, which is May, June time, so it's cold, and so they're not going to expect people to come out in the cold like that, and it's supposed to rain and everything else. And so from the time of the dedication and the tent getting shredded up until the time that the meetings are supposed to start, it's raining, it's cold weather, there's problems, they're praying, they're interceding, they're saying, God, what do we do? And one woman pops up and says that the clouds will be the covering, and, you know, and anyway, I can't remember what all the prophecy was, and Reinhard goes, okay, that's God, we're going with it. So they start the meetings, and the first night, 70,000 people show up. So the 35,000-seater tent was too small. And so the day that the meeting started, the skies cleared up and they stayed clear, and there was a covering for them for the entire time of the meeting. The enemy will come out to resist you, to try to stop you from what God has placed in your heart, what God has placed in your life. But he is a liar and the truth is not in him. We have all power and authority in Jesus' name. It doesn't matter the circumstances. It doesn't matter the things that try to come against us and hinder us and try to push us back. God is greater if we will keep over here in this place of rejoicing and thanksgiving. The scripture tells us to be thankful in all things, for this is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus. So when the trial gets big, we don't go and fall apart about it. We say, Father, we're thankful that you brought us here so we can take a hold in a greater way of what you were doing. You brought us here. Now, Father, you're going to strengthen us in the midst of this trying time. You're going to do greater things. Reinhard Bonnke could have said, well, it's going to take 3 years for me to come back because it's going to take 3 years to get another tent made like that. And he could have waited 3 years. Or he could have prayed and interceded and touched heaven and went with what God said, and then 70,000 show up. And it's again and again, it's every one of us. We are going to have trials come against us to try to stop us. And Father allows it, because are we going to be valiant? Are we going to make up our mind that we are on the winning side and the enemy's not going to have his way? God is going to have his way in our life, because we're going to worship and we're going to praise. There is power in thanksgiving. There is power. You know, in Ephesians chapter 4, we'll just start with verse 1. Therefore, the prisoner of the Lord. Here Paul is, he's the prisoner of the Lord. Other people say, I'm in prison over here because of the enemy and everything's gone wrong and the people lied about me and the people da 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 da. Paul says, I'm the prisoner of the Lord. God brought me here and I will fulfill the purpose that he has for me while I'm in this prison. And Paul did great things in the prison. God did bring him there. And God used him mightily. I, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you, I beg you, I plead with you, I urge you that you might walk worthy of this vocation, of this calling, that you might walk worthy, that you might walk worthy, look at that, oh Jesus, that you might walk worthy of the gift of all of heaven that has been handed to you and granted to you. Here's heaven, here's all the gift of heaven. Here's everything that Jesus Christ paid for. And I beg you, walk worthy. Walk worthy. Take a hold of this. And walk worthy. Hold on. Well, I'll stay right here. Wherewith you are called, with all lowliness, meekness. And this is saying how. How? Lowliness and meekness. Because this is who we are in Christ Jesus. This is the new man. This is the new man. We want to walk in the new man. We don't want to walk in the fallen nature. The Lord lays it out in the scripture again and again. Don't go back over to the old man, the fallen nature. Stay over here in the new man. Be renewed in your mind. Put on the new man. This is who I've made you. This is what I've done in you. Put on this new man. Walk in lowliness and meekness and long-suffering, forbearing one another in love. Counterattack of the enemy is what it is. Every time the enemy brings one of his fiery darts to your mind of something, of it could be self-defense, it could be, you know, whatever. Somebody did something bad to you, they hurt you, so plot of how to hurt them back. You know, and you're like, where did that come from? Fiery dart. Counterattacked it with the word of God. The word of God says, walk in lowliness and meekness and love. Now how can I be a blessing? How can I love? How can I lay down my life? And so you go back and you go, I'm living over here in the new man. This is who I am in Christ Jesus. I'm not coming under that bondage of the fallen man. I'm not joining leagues with Adam and what he did and giving Satan the place and the rule that he did not have. Satan was cast out of heaven. He did not have authority over man, and Adam gave it back to him. Satan does not have authority over you because you are bought with a price. Yeah. Do not give him place. Yeah. And that's on down here. We're getting there. Endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. Yeah. Give everything that you got to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace with everyone you possibly can. Give everything. If it takes cutting off your hand, give everything it takes to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. Endeavor with all of your might, like a good soldier, fighting a good warfare, fighting a good fight. You're going to keep unity. You're going to walk in love, because this is what God's called you to. God has called you to this. So you're going to do it because this is who you are and you can. That's the greatest part about it is you can. You're not a slave like those that are out there under the bondage of Satan that have to do whatever the enemy tells them to do at his will. You're not stuck in human love and human compassion and human ability. You're over here in the realms of heaven and you can. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. You can be a good soldier. You can. Because it's His strength and it's His might on the inside of you doing every good and perfect work. Every good and perfect work. There is one body and one spirit. So endeavor to keep the unity of the spirit and the bond of peace because there's only one Holy Ghost. And we all should be doing the same thing and saying the same thing and walking the same way. That's why we get the same words. That's why we hear the same thing that God's saying through Pastor Mark or through this other pastor, and it just all comes together. You know, the Lord gives me a word. And I'm hearing this, and it's just exploding on the inside of me. And then I turn somebody on YouTube. And look, I look for those Holy Ghost people that are separated unto God. I don't, you know, I'm not listening to every little bit of thing that's out there. You know? There's so many bones to spit out for the good that you don't want to be spitting out. You don't want to go there. But I turn somebody on the YouTube, directed by the Holy Ghost. I mean, it's just like God's done so many things. I've walked into a bookstore, looked up, found a little tiny book. God said, read that book. Buy that book, read that book. I've never read very many books because I read the Bible. I need the Word of God. And I got to get this in me. And if I read a bunch of other books, how am I going to get into the Word? But this one was called The Acts of the Holy Spirit. And it talked about the Paraclete. And I mean, I read that book till I almost wore it out. And then I came out to California. This is when we were in Texas. I came out to California. I gave that book to Mark. And he read that book and he started preaching on the Paraclete. I mean, God put that book in my hand. I didn't go into Bible bookstores. I didn't buy books. I walked into that Bible bookstore one day, walked over to a shelf, looked up. I mean, it's just like I was right there. You know why? Because it was a divine appointment. And so anyway, that's how I turn the TV on and watch those guys. So here is what God's speaking to me. This minister's preaching it. And then I go and I pick up Jeannie Wilkerson's book. I just felt inspired to read in her book. I've had it, and I haven't got to really read past the introduction. And I open up to a chapter, and if she's not ministering the exact same thing that the Lord was talking to me, the guy on the minister on the YouTube was ministering on, it was right there in that whole chapter. And I'm like, oh, Lord Jesus. And of course, it was on prayer and the power of prayer and what God can do through a person in prayer, how He can take you and He can cause things to happen because you give yourself to prayer and you give yourself to the things of the Spirit, not the things of this life, not the things of this world. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, only one. So endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. Endeavor. Do everything that you can. And if somebody's preaching and they've got off a little bit wrong on the wrong way, we need to love on them anyway. They may have got messed up, but we need to get on our knees and pray for them. Because I tell you, sometimes, and most of the time, people get in the ministry and they're not fortified. And, you know, personally, I've wanted to step at it real slowly because I've watched too many people go under not being fortified, not knowing how to stand in prayer, not having a prayer life, not having that good, solid foundation of the Word and prayer. And they get into ministry and they fall into all kinds of stuff that they shouldn't be into, but they were affecting people. People were getting saved. Lots of people were coming to Jesus. And then all of a sudden they're attacked. We don't need to go and put our foot on top of them and go blah, 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 blah. We need to get on our knees and pray that God will show them the truth, that they can see the light. Don't give up on them, for crying out loud. Don't give up on them. Get on your knees and pray. I mean, Mel Gibson's getting ready. I don't know if he's already done it, but I know he's getting ready to do this sequel to The Passion, and it's called The Resurrection. And when he did The Passion, I got on my knees and started praying for the man. I said, because this is gonna come against him. And, you know, he was married, had 6 kids, married to a wife for a long time. After that, he ended up getting divorced, all kinds of stuff. You know, the fortification of the saints. So I'm on my knees praying for Mel Gibson. He's getting ready to do a radical movie. I'm praying that that movie is by the Holy Ghost and the enemy can't get his hands in it anyway. And it will shake nations. And then we want to pray for Mel Gibson and everybody that's a part of it, because the enemy comes out against it to try to stop it and try to bring the attack and try to make the person look bad or whatever to disqualify what was said by the Spirit and what was done in the Holy Ghost. In every way. And so that's preachers. And so, you know, we want to be the fortification on our knees in prayer, crying out to God for them. And one puts 1,000, two puts 10,000, three puts 1,000,000, 100,000, four 1,000,000. And that's my calculation. And Jeremy and somebody might straighten us out, and because he was explaining all God's way. He could tell you that. But anyway, that's how I was seeing it in the Spirit, as I, you know, just been meditating on it, praying, talking to the Lord about it. But anyway, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, the power that we have in the name of Jesus, the power that we have on our knees. Our conduct of righteousness changes the atmosphere. Our words in response. Our action changed the atmosphere. We have authority over the atmosphere if we walk in Him. And the more righteous people gathered together, the increase of righteousness. And it increases more than any of the things that the devil does. People focus on what the devil does. And they go, oh, that's going to spread like wildfire. Yeah, it will, unless the saints start praying and binding it. Yes. And if the saints come against it in the name of Jesus, it's going to have to get out. Because yes. We have the power and the authority. And the people can either let the demons leave them and leave the nation, or they can leave the nation with the devil if they want to. But if we will bind together as God's people and stand and live in holiness and righteousness and be fortified in the things of the kingdom, then we will turn the battle to the gate. Hallelujah. We want to be those that turn the battle to the gate, not be running from the battle. Yeah, a battle's come against you. So fight. Yeah, the enemy's come against you. So what you gonna do about it? Whine? Sit down? Fall apart? Let him have his way? Get over on his side and just, you know, whine and, and not saying this, but you open the door to the whining and the complaining. You need to make it a point that you do not allow complaining whatsoever. Amen. I mean, if something don't taste good, find something good to say about it. I mean, just don't have complaining. Just don't let it come out of your mouth. If you've been given to strife where you've got to talk about somebody, make it a point that you don't say nothing about any other person. Nothing. Just nothing. Talk about you. Talk about, you know, something. But just find yourself not complaining and not allowed to say one word about anybody. Don't open the door to that. Because strife brings envy, and envy brings jealousy, hatred, murder. I mean, those demons hang out together, and they just get worse, and they explode. And it's all in the place of rebellion. And where rebellion is, there's witchcraft. And if you're speaking evil about somebody, you say just one little thing about that is degrading about that person, you are speaking a curse. So are you a curser or are you a blesser? Do you bless with your mouth or do you curse with your mouth? I'm going to tell you, if you're speaking curses, God ain't on your side. And it's just a fact. He's not. He isn't on your side. Hallelujah. I've been praying for people in Mississippi on the telephone quite a bit. And so I get to talking to them, and that country slang really comes back even stronger than what I've already got it. I've got such a mix of this and that from being an evangelist child and traveling all over the country. Thank you, Jesus. So hallelujah. Did I ever get to the scripture there that I was trying to read? That first one in the... Where am I at? Give no place to the devil. Okay, so it's in verse 27. So anyway, skipping down, we'll skip down and we'll just touch on verse 22. But ye put off concerning the former conversation the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust. We put that off. He's the old man. He's the fallen nature. The fallen nature doesn't come into the divine nature. The new nature is the divine nature. It's the nature of God. So the new nature is continually looking at the Word, because we're washed by the water of the Word. We're transformed by the renewing of our minds. We're transformed by the Word of God coming and showing us who we are. We're looking into that perfect law of liberty, and we're discovering who we are and what He's done in us, in this new divine nature. We've put that old man off. We don't allow him to creep over here into this new man. And we're still keepers of the garden. And we look at Adam and Eve, and we look at how they blew it, and we're like, if I was Eve, I would have never talked to the devil, and I wouldn't have gone straight to that tree. Well, the tree is still around, but in a different form. It's called the old nature, the fallen nature. And everything that is to do with the fallen nature is over there. But we've been given the new nature. And God says, don't go over there and don't touch it. Don't have any part of it. Don't eat of it. Don't allow it in your life. This is what I've done for you. Now come over here and walk. Come over here and walk in what I've done, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new nature, the new man, the new nature, the divine nature, the nature that comes from heaven, the nature that was imparted to you in the new birth, the new nature that Jesus paid for through His blood, that when you received His blood, you received the divine nature. That's who you are. That's what you are. And when if you take a hold of what He's done, you're not going to allow the enemy to creep over into what He's done in the new. You're going to walk it out. You're going to live it in Him. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. And that you put on the new man, which after God has created in righteousness and holiness. God is righteous, He is holy, and He's not hanging out with any of the other garbage. He's righteous and He's holy, and if what you're doing is not righteous and holy, you want to rethink. It's not in the new nature, and so you put it away. You put it away. You go, no, that's not the new nature. That's not who God is. God made me like Him. He made me righteous and holy. This right here, it says this is a new nature created in righteousness and holiness. If it's not righteousness and holiness, then I'm not going to walk in it. I'm not going to have any part of it. I'm not going to live in it. I'm not going to dwell there. I'm going to put up that shield of faith. I'm going to have on that whole armor. I'm going to stand against the wiles of the devil. I'm going to keep that armor on. I'm going to prepare myself with the gospel of peace. I'm going to get shot up. I'm going to have on that breastplate of righteousness. That breastplate, you think about that. I was thinking about, man, it'd be nice if I had Miles to fix me one of those breastplates. You know, all that stuff he creates. But the breastplate in the battle in that time, it completely covered. And first of all, they were put on the girdle of truth. They gird their loins with truth. And that was a tying this area right here with truth. And it was put on them tightly. And then everything else in the armor, that helped hold it up, the truth. We've got the gospel of truth around our loins. We're girt up with the gospel of truth. If the truth is there, the enemy's not getting past the truth, because the truth expels the lie. The truth sets you free. When you hear the word of God, the truth sets you free. You receive the truth and then you get free. You're renewed in the spirit of your mind through the truth, through the word of God. And so then they put that breastplate on, and that breastplate covered everything, every one of those sensitive parts in here. It was covered front and back, so nothing could get through. It was a metal shield, and the sword couldn't get through that. And that's the breastplate of righteousness. That's who He's made us. when we look at ourselves as we are righteous, we are holy. And we want to stay over here in this righteousness and holiness. Yeah. And anyway, when you're having that communion and that fellowship with God, that's all you want. Yeah. So if you just stay over here in this place. But you know, Jesus, when he was really, to me, he was like saying, now, Peter, John, James, it's your turn. Watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. The Spirit's willing. But this natural body is going to get tired and you're going to fall asleep. And there's times that you can't fall asleep, man. You just can't. There's a battle afoot. There's things going on and the enemy's out trying to fight against you. And God will give you the strength to watch, to be vigilant. And you look at the watch in that. When you're in the military, I don't know if anybody in here has been in the military. I don't see Tyler. But when you're in the military and you're put on watch duty and you're in the middle of a battle and you're one of the watchmen, you get watch. You're watching, is the enemy coming? Because, and everybody's counting on you to watch while they're getting a little bit of rest to fight the battle tomorrow. You're going to get to rest tomorrow while they're fighting, if the possibility is for rest, if the battle's not too hot. But when you're watching, you've got to be vigilant. You've got to watch what's going on. Because, you know, the enemy as a roaring lion comes around seeking whom he may devour. He's looking for tactics and ways to get in. You know, there's been these little cracks that you may have opened the door to the enemy at times. And he's like, I know what I can do. They're getting too radical. Things are looking too good. They're touching people's lives. And I know this one worked last time. So he's going to come up and he's going to try and he's going to make it look good and give it every reason and every reason for you to self-justify your situation and for you to get offended, wounded, hurt, or whatever it is. Every reason for you to fall into that thing again. Every reason for an excuse. But God's people learn the devices of the enemy. They get aware of them. And they're like, oh, you may have got me there before. But no way in Jesus' name. I'm standing in him. He's in me and I'm in him. And Jesus prayed that I would be kept from you. Jesus prayed that I'd be kept from the evil one. And I'm staying over here and I'm going to be kept. And I'm not coming under that thing again. Aware of the enemy's devices. I'm not doing it again. You may have got me, you may have hit me, you may have knocked me down, but I'm getting up in the name of Jesus and I'm going to run like I've never ran before. I'm going to be mighty in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He may knock you down, but the good thing is, the awesome thing is God forgives. If we sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. Not when, but if we do, if we're still children tossed to and fro by every wind of dark doctrine, if we haven't grown up, if we haven't been those babies that desire the sincere milk of the Word enough to grow thereby, then we can go right back to that sincere milk of the Word and we can let it change us and form us into His image and strengthen us and empower us to be like Him. Yeah. Oh, thank you, Jesus, that we didn't eat of the tree one time and it'd be over. And it even wasn't even over for Adam and Eve. They could repent. Thank God. But they brought such a mess upon all men. And the enemy's out to try to keep you from your destiny and your calling, but you can rise up and say, you're not, in Jesus' name. Because I'm going to be over here in this Word, and it's going to strengthen me, and I'm going to get down on my knees. And there's a discipline at times to get down on your knees, because things will come and make you so busy. You know, I'm just at the point, you know, I've been thinking here lately, if I'm in the store or whatever, and it's that noontime prayer, I'm just thinking, why do I care what people think if I get down on my knees and just say, thank you, Jesus, and raise my hands up to Jesus? People get down and do all kinds of stuff. They say ugly words around you all the time. They blast that crazy music. If you try to go in the store to do some business, they got this nasty, trashy music. If I start praying in the Holy Ghost, the radio might bust. Or whatever it is, it's not even a radio anymore. It's all kinds of electronic doodads that they... I haven't figured all that stuff out. I'm sorry, I'm just, you know, I do enough electronics to get by with. But anyway... Thank you, Jesus. I mean, what does it matter what they think? It's going to change the atmosphere of where I'm at. Because it's just all about Jesus. It's all about Him. It's all about what He wants to do with our life being lost and hid in Him. People go, oh, don't cast your pearls before swine. You better be casting something. You better be doing something to stand against the powers of darkness. You don't want to be hiding it in a napkin waiting for Him to come someday and say, I got it held here, right here. He'll go, you unprofitable servant. And He'll take what you have and He'll give it to another. Jesus. I don't want Him to take what He's given me and give it to somebody else. So we're going to be vigilant. We're going to fight this good fight of faith. We're going to lay hold on eternal life. I haven't got to my scripture yet. Wherefore, putting away lying, speak every man the truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Be angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down on your wrath, neither give place to the devil. And people go, how do you do that? And right there it says, don't be who you were. That's who you were. We've got to lay it out in Galatians. We've got to lay it out all through Ephesians. We've got to lay it out all throughout the Word of God. That's the old nature, the old man, the fallen man. I think it's good to say fallen man. They may have should have translated that, the fallen man. The fallen man is put away. He's dead. The divine man, the divine nature, the holy nature, the righteous nature, the nature of God is what we have. Through His goodness and His mercy and His great love that He has for us, because we do not deserve it, never did, never could, never would be able to be good enough to have what He has done. So glorious, but it's ours. And we have to fight for that. And condemnation will come against to fight for that. So that's another thing that you don't allow. You don't allow condemnation because it fights against what God has done in you. It resists. It's a resistance of the enemy. It's come out to resist you. You know, a lot there's so many people that, you know, a lot of things won't detour them. They're not interested in that. Interested, you know, they turn away from it. And then the enemy comes out with just beating them over the head with, you know, some little mistake, or they did, you know, this or that or whatever. And what you got to realize is that's your ability. It's what Christ has done in you. Now you stand in Him. Amen. It's standing in Him, not in you. Amen. That's going back to the law on your ability. You're standing in Christ Jesus and what He's done on the cross. And now you're victorious. You're victorious even if you fall, because you can get back up and say, I'm going to go fight the battle again. I will win. I will win through Jesus Christ. It's when you give up and you don't get back up and you get discouraged over the circumstances that are around you that the enemy has you totally cornered. But you can still get up and get out of the corner. You can still get up and get out of the mud. If you fall physically into the mud, you're not going to lay there and just say, all right, I'm all dirty. So, I mean, you know, I might as well, you know, I fell into the mud. This is serious mud. I'm covered with mud. So I might as well just be like a pig and wallow the rest of my life. You're going to get up and go take a shower. The shower is going to wash you and make you clean. The blood of Jesus will make you clean. It's faster than that shower will make you clean. Way faster than that shower will make you clean. Oh, glory. Look what the Lord has done for us. Look what the Lord has done for us. Look at what He's done. And it just lays it out. If you stole, steal no more. Because I'm going to tell you, the wages of sin is death. And whatever you reap, you're going to sow. If you sow to the flesh, you're going to of the flesh reap corruption. If you sow to the Spirit, you're going to of the Spirit reap eternal life. If you steal, then you open the door for the enemy to steal from you. If you lie, you open the door for the enemy to bring lies to you. If you don't forgive, you open the enemy to bring all kinds of things against you. And Number one, if you don't forgive, your Heavenly Father can't forgive you. And you look at forgive, it's like foreknowledge. Forgive is like foreknowledge. Forgive is like before they ask for forgiveness and if they never do. Because we don't know if those guys standing around the cross that crucified Jesus, and we don't know how many of the scribes and the Pharisees repented, but Jesus said, forgive them all, Father, for they know not what they do. Oh, God, have mercy. That's basically what he was doing, is, Father, your mercy. Your mercy. They don't realize that they're killing the Prince of Peace. They don't realize what they're doing. So forgive them. And that's how we forgive. Not when somebody comes and bows down to us and says, I have been a rotten, miserable, low down scallywag. You know, God reaches out to the rotten, miserable, low down. I guess scallywag's not used here. That's an old country term. Anyway, it's from the South. I was in the South a long time. Dad preached in the South a long time. Anyway, God doesn't do that to you. He reaches out to you. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He showed the greatest love, and that's what he's called us to do. When someone hurts you, you show them the greatest love, because your Father lives on the inside of you. By this shall all men know that we are his disciples, by the love that we have one for another, by the agape, by the God type of love, because he's in us, and we can, because he's enabled us to. We can do it. We can. We are a can. We can, people. We can do all things through Christ. We can live out this divine nature because he gave it to us. We can. We can. We can. We can do this. We don't have to give any place to the enemy who wants to destroy us, who all that he has is misery. It may look good, it may be pleasure for a moment, but it ends up in complete death and misery. Sin brings death. Yeah. The wages of sin has not changed through the history of time. It's still the same. Wages have changed. Minimum wages change continually in the United States of America since I was young. But the wages of sin have not changed. They will bring forth death. And so if you sow to the flesh the corruption, you'll reap that. You'll reap. You'll reap. And it happens in this life. But you know what? There's even good news there. You may sow a whole bunch of bad seed while you're trying to walk with God and you haven't really taken a hold of the divine nature, and you might sow a bunch of mess. But you repent and you get to reap eternal life. Amen. You repent and you don't have to reap that mess you sowed. Amen. You repent and God will take every bit of that mess you made and he will turn it around. I've watched him do it way too many times. And I know that when you come to the blood of Jesus Christ and you take a hold of it and you repent and you begin to walk with God, you stop reaping the mess that's behind you. Isn't that good? Oh, hallelujah. As long as you hang out with it and you keep the door open, you're going to reap. You're going to reap the same things you're sowing. You're going to reap it. It's going to happen to you. You just watch. You're going to reap the fruit of your lips. You're going to reap them. You're going to reap it. I watch people, you know, and they're Christians, supposedly, you know, and there's some that are, and they're just learning to walk with God, and they don't have any idea. They're just stupid Christians. They haven't learned to walk in the Spirit. They haven't learned to walk in what God's given them. You know, they're trying, but they do a bunch of stupidity. And I hear them say stuff, and I just go, I've been down this road for a long time. And you just opened a door by your mouth. Keep your mouth shut. Filter it through this right here. Find out what's the divine nature. And filter it through what he has done in us. Filter your words. Don't blah, 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 blah. In a multitude of words, there's no want for sin. A lot of blah, 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 blah. If you need to get with your friends and have a lot of blah, 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 pray. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Just pray in the Holy Ghost. And then a lot of blah, blah, blah won't get you in a lot of trouble. Because I'm telling you what, you open your mouth and you start saying stuff, you're going to find yourself in the same, you know, especially criticizing people. Because I've watched people criticize other people and say blah, blah, blah about them and how that they would never do it. And then I watch them and go, mm-hmm, you acting just like what you said you would never do, because you know why you opened your mouth and you criticized. Because that's evil. Don't criticize. Pray. Say, Father, I thank you that you love this person. And you may have given me a word of knowledge about what they're doing here. And the reason you gave me this word of knowledge is so I can come in here with prayer and I can fortify and I can undergird them. I can lift them up before the throne room. I can take them before your throne of grace. And I can go in the spirit of meekness and in love and bring restoration in any way that Father will let me bring restoration and how he'll speak through me. And then maybe I can save a soul from hell. Hallelujah. That's what God's doing. That's the new nature. That's the divine nature. That's who we are. We're not going, well, there. But yet we find God's people do that instead of falling upon their face and crying out when they see their brother stumble. The love of God. The love of God reaches down and brings us up. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And then, you know, I'm going to go on down. I'm going to try to get through this real quickly. Let him that stole steal no more, but rather labor, working with his hands, the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that's in need. So instead of stealing, work and labor with your hands so you can be a blessing. And that's how God is. Go the opposite of what the devil did. How the devil tries to ruin you. Just go the opposite. Labor hard with your hands so instead of being a thief, you can be a giver. Yeah. Isn't that more awesome to go home and lay down at night and know that you labored and you gave, as to go home and lay down at night and be in misery because you stole and you're under a demonic oppression of stealing? Rich people steal. Rich people steal because they come under that demon power of darkness, and so they steal because it's a demon. They don't steal because they need anything. They steal because they're under the demon power of darkness and it has a grip on their life. And they don't want to steal because stealing goes to prison, makes them go to prison and ruins their life. And there's been movie stars that had good careers and they were caught stealing and it destroyed their career. And they went to prison because of their stealing habit. And they didn't need to steal. That's the devil. That's who people want to serve. Why? I don't know. And God's people surely shouldn't be serving the devil. We should be looking over here at what God's done. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth. None. No corrupt communication. But that which is good, that which is God-like, just like God, out of that place of holiness and righteousness. If God wouldn't say it, then shut up and don't say it either. And he probably wouldn't say this, so I'm going to quit saying it. My husband gets on to me for saying those words. If God wouldn't say it, don't say it either. Holiness. Be like Jesus. Be like Jesus. To the use of edifying. So if we're going to say something about somebody, we want to be edifying them. We want to be encouraging them. We want to be lifting them up. We want to be looking for what's good. Let's look at what's good. Let's not look at what's bad. Let's look at what's good. And if we'll sow that with our mouth, we'll reap it with what comes back to us. And it's good to be edified by the Father, isn't it? Yeah. To be strengthened and encouraged by the Father instead of spanked for continually letting your mouth get off in a place that it shouldn't be. That it may minister grace unto the hearers. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Let your mouth edify and minister grace to the hearers. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed into the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking put away from you with all malice. And be ye kind one to another. Isn't the Word of God so good? Yeah. All of these things are horrible. Why participate when you could be kind? kindness, that's the fruit of the Spirit. I mean, I like that. Lord, I'm just like, Father, I want to be kind. Father, I thank you for kindness. I thank you, Father God, that I flow in kindness, in love, in goodness, in meekness, in gentleness. Be kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you. And that's the forgiveness. That's the forgiveness that goes beyond anybody ever asking you to forgive them. You forgive them and you love them when they're miserable, mean, and ugly, because you're bringing the gospel of Jesus Christ to them. Thank you, Jesus. That's what God's called us to live in that. And then I just want to go over here real quick to 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 12. And there's just so much that the Lord's given me. If we could just go through all the scriptures, it would be wonderful. But, you know, if we take a hold of what the Holy Spirit's saying and we go and we pursue the Word of God in our own time with the Lord, then it just gets bigger and it gets deeper. And then we come together and it's just like we can go on and get some more meat of the Word and see great things in God happen. And I'm in expectation for great things to happen. Yes. Because I'm seeing God bring His church together. Amen. In unity. I'm seeing God bring people together where they're gathered up and they're prepared for what God's doing. They're not putting their life in this world above the things of the kingdom. If we love the world, the love of the Father's not in us. No man that wars, no man that wars for God, warreth. I was trying to get away from that worth, that old English word. No man that wars in the kingdom of God entangles himself in the affairs of this life that he may please him who has chosen him. Yes. We don't get entangled. We're in the world, but we're not of the world. We don't have fellowship with the world. We're not friends with the world. That means we're not friends with worldly people. We go there, we minister to them, we love them, but they're not our friends. We can't have, what communion and what fellowship has light with darkness? There is no fellowship. There can only be a one-sided ministry and a patience and a love to impart. But if you're not in a place to minister to people, you should not be hanging around worldly people whatsoever. You separate yourself from them. If you know that you're not strong enough to minister the light of the gospel to them and you're going to get caught up in anything that they're doing, you have no place of being there. Jesus was a friend to the publicans and the sinners, but only in the sense that he dominated the atmosphere where he was at. And I mean, there was revival, there was church. He went into somebody's house and they had church. I mean, the glory of heaven was all in the place. People were falling at his feet, repenting, crying, wiping his feet with their tears, getting saved, delivered, set free. People were in awe. The religious were there mocking and going, who, what is he? You know, and the religious are always going to be that. And you can be sitting in a church as good as the Abiding Place and become religious. Anything outside of loving people, love covers a multitude of sins. I tell you what, people, we're growing up together. Amen. And so therefore, we just love each other in the middle of the things that we're growing in. We have to look at everybody and say, we're growing together. I've come a long way. Thank you, Jesus. And thank God that Pastor Mark put up with me in my growing. And we just love each other. We love each other. I tell you, you know, it's so easy for parents to see their kids and just love them right in the middle of everything they're doing. We love them, and we're not letting go. We're not letting up. We're not backing down. And other people might see problems, but a parent can hardly see anything. It's just amazing. And God wants us to love one another like that. We're growing together. We're body. We're the family. We're the family of God. We are family. And whether it takes people a long time to grow up or if they grow up rapidly, whatever. Everybody's going to go through battles. Everybody's going to be tempted. Everybody's going to go through a struggle. But we can overcome because He overcame for us. Anyway, verse 12, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold. Lay hold. Lay hold. Take a hold of what he's done. Don't let go. Heaven's worth fighting for. Heaven in this life, on this earth, is worth fighting for, because it doesn't matter when we lay hold of him and we won't let go, and it's impossible for the grip to be let go because we're in him and he's in us, and the communion and the fellowship is so deep that we will not be separated from him. We will not let ourselves go out, because he will not let go of us unless we turn around and we walk away from him. It doesn't matter what goes on around us. We still stand in heaven and in bliss on earth, in the middle of affliction, in the middle of suffering. If we're in prison, we're rejoicing and we're thankful. Amen. If we're being tortured, God will give us the strength. Whatever he has us go through, he gives us the strength to endure it and to bear it for his name's sake. We just keep rejoicing and we're thankful. Just keep being thankful, because this is the will of God, and there's power in thankfulness. There's power in the prayer. There's power in praise. There's power in obedience to change the atmosphere. So lay hold. Lay hold on these things. Lay hold. You know, and just before that, I mean, it's amazing. It says, And I want to bring this in. We'll start with verse 6. But godliness with contentment is great gain. Godliness with contentment is great gain. That's riches. When you're happy, no matter what you have or what it looks like. When you're thankful and you're happy. Because when you're happy and you're thankful with what you have, God can always give you more. But we brought nothing into this world, neither can we take anything out. You're not going to take it with you. And having food and raiment, let us therewith be content. It doesn't even say a house here. It just says food and raiment. It doesn't even say shelter. It says let us be happy and thankful. Isn't that amazing? Americans don't even comprehend that. Now, if you went over into the Philippines or in some of the other third world countries, they would get it. You know, because they have, a lot of places in the Philippines, they just have little cardboard boxes that they kind of put up for shelter. And they, you know, try to keep all their clothes. I mean, what we see here of the homeless people walking down the street with their cart and their backpacks or whatever they've got, all their stuff that they're carrying, that's just a common thing in the Philippines or in, you know, many of these other countries of the world. They just have little makeshift houses, and some of them don't even have that. You know, they might work and get an umbrella and put it up over them at night to sleep under when it's raining. And the sewage just runs down the street. And some of them, the kids, you know, play in it because they don't know any better. Because that's all they've had. That's all they've known. And we're just so abundantly blessed. The poorest of us all are abundantly blessed in this country. The poorest of the poor are blessed. I mean, there are some that are in dire situation, dire straits, like kids I've heard of that the parents take them and just dump them out downtown on the streets and leave them there, 10, 11, 12, 13 years old. And you know what? The sinners go and pick them up and teach them every evil, wicked thing, instead of God's people going picking them up and putting them in a place of shelter. Isn't it amazing? But we're real busy. We're busy. Jesus. But they that will be rich fall into temptation and snare and into many foolish, hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil. See, that's getting entangled in the world. When you feel like, I got to have more, I got to do more, I got to be more, I've got to, you know, da 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 da. And, you know, people are really caught up in that. And not to say that God won't bless you, because he will, and he can. But that's not where your heart needs to be. Your heart needs to be in the kingdom. Seek first the kingdom of God. And when your focus is on seeking first the kingdom of God, it's like Reinhard Bonnke out on the streets for years. God was looking and seeing, is he going to be faithful? He's looking at you and he's saying, are you going to be faithful? I want to give you more. I want to bless you with more. I want the riches to come from heaven. But this is talking about, and I really believe it's talking about you going and seeking after it and you trying to have it. And then you're entangled with all kinds of deceitful things, all kinds of destruction that would take you down and it grip your soul. But if you seek first the kingdom of God, if everything that you're doing, your job and everything that you're doing is about seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, in no way do you ever put the seeking of money and riches above the kingdom of heaven. But you put aside those things and seek first the kingdom of heaven, and that's just a part of how you're doing it, how you're seeking first the kingdom of heaven. Because, I mean, we lay it all out, you know. We're to labor, we just talked about, labor working with your hands that you may be able to give. And he that doesn't provide for his house is worse than an infidel. And he that does not work should not eat. So, it's not just drop everything you're doing and, you know, expect somebody else to give you money unless God tells you to go do something like that. You know, because like Reinhard went to Africa with the pledge of $110 a month. And that's the only pledge he had. So I don't know what all he did to sustain his family while he was there, but, you know, God gives you all kinds of ability to work with your hands, to get there and not get stuck and depend on people that forget that they made the pledge. And most Christians, most churches, if you don't go back every year and spend half of the time that you could be out on the mission field ministering, and if you don't go back every year to all the different churches that pledge that little bit of money that keeps you going, if you don't go back to every one of them, then they forget about you. You have to go back and tell them what's going on. And so you have to take all that time for the mission field to go back and be able to explain that, you know, things are really happening or you're totally forgotten about. And so many people get off on the mission field and everybody forgets the pledges. And so it's good to know how to work labor with your hands wherever you go. And God will bless it because, you know, we see the example of Paul. He was a tent maker. And he could have done more. He didn't need to make tents. You know, if he would have stayed over there and just been caught up on what he could do financially, because he was a Pharisee above, you know, a Pharisee of Pharisees. And in that was a lot of money. He was a lawyer. He had a lot of wealth at his disposal, but he worked with his hands laboring that the churches, he wouldn't be charged by any of the churches. They couldn't put anything on him that they were the ones that took care of his needs. He took care of them. Isn't that amazing? So full of the gospel. And didn't stop for one moment for what God's purpose and plan was for his life. Didn't back up and say, well, we need to go regroup. Thank you, Jesus. Because he's able to supply all your needs when he's given you a call and he's put it in there. When he's, you know, and we want to walk worthy of this calling, this vocation. It's a vocation. It's our job description. It's our calling and our job description. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some have coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. It's just seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And it's given ourselves to live the kingdom life so we can turn upside down what the enemy has planned for our lives and for the lives of our nation, our family, our nation. We stand and we fight that good fight of faith and we lay hold. And we see the eternal purposes of God for somebody that's messing up and doing it wrong and stumbling over themselves and just hasn't got it right. And we reach out and we love and we pray and we do everything that we can to bring restoration, because that's who God is and that's what he's done for you so many times. Look at what he's done. Look how he's kept you. Look how good he's been. There's nothing out there worth changing all of heaven for. There's nothing. It's misery. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Father, we praise you. We glorify your name. Everybody just stand with me. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, what he's done for us. Father, I just thank you that you're raising up a church. And I pray continually, Father, and I pray continually that the Father would make us all prayer warriors, that we'll be a people of prayer. We'll be a people that cry out to him. And we'll be rooted and grounded in that, in the word and in prayer. Because he told us again and again the scripture. We could have gone over all the scriptures of watch and pray. Watch and pray. Watch and pray with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Because the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous man will avail much. Yes. And when you've learned to pray, your prayer just gets more effective, more effectual. It gets more fervent. It goes deeper, and it avails much. And it takes down the powers of darkness that would resist. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Father. We praise you, Lord. We thank you for your anointing. Hallelujah, Jesus. 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 Father, we just thank you that your word goes deep down on the inside of us. Father, we thank you for this fellowship. We thank you, God, for this breaking bread with you tonight. Father, we thank you, God, for your love that you have for us and what you're doing in every one of us. Father, I just thank you that you strengthen every person. I want to give everybody an opportunity to come and get prayed for. If you have anything, you know, the scripture says, you know, we want to look at the scripture and we want to do what the Bible says. You know, if in James it says, if you're afflicted, if you're in suffering, pray. So if you're in a battle, pray. Pray till you get through the battle. Don't pray a little bit and give up. Pray. It says, if there's any sick among you, let him call for the elders of the church and they'll lay hands on him. And the prayer of faith will save the sick. And if he's committed any sin, it will be forgiven him. Look at that, how good God is. If he's committed any sin. It doesn't say that because they're sick, they did. But if it's sickness because they did, it's forgiven. Yeah. This is my God. So if there's anybody in here that needs prayer, you need encouragement, you need strength, you need somebody to lay hands on you and pray with you, we'll be glad to tonight to pray with you. But we want to give you an opportunity to come and worship the Lord with what he's blessed you with. And we just, we pray that everyone, and you know, and just anybody that wants to just take some time in prayer, you're welcome to stay and pray. And, you know, everybody else that feels like they need to go after you come and you worship the Lord with what he's blessed you with, you're free to go, but just love one another. Let somebody know you love them tonight. Let somebody know that they're important to you. Thank you, Jesus. And you're there to bear one another's burdens. We're here to bear one another's burdens. Let people know that you're there to bear with their burdens. Let them know that you care. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus.
Spirit, take my life and place me on the altar of your praise. Let your fire fall, let your fire burn in me. Holy Spirit, take my life and place me on the altar of your praise. Let your fire fall, let your fire burn.
Everybody that's standing around, you can join me in prayer that wants to. If you need to go, you can go. But if you want to join me in prayer as we're praying together. Thank you. You know, I want to talk to everybody that's here. You know, discouragement comes against all God's people. You know, it's an attack that is strong with some people. And it's just over and over again because you begin to look at your failures. Well, you don't begin to look at them. The enemy begins to go, blah! And you become discouraged. And in that discouragement is where the enemy begins to have his way. You know, you can find yourself falling again and again because you allowed discouragement. And you just get messed up because of discouragement. What did King David do? Well, he wasn't king yet. He was anointed king, but he had not become king yet. When him and his valiant men, this is in the time that he's running from Saul, and him and his valiant men were out fighting the battle, and the enemy came in and took their wives, their children, all of their stuff, took everything. What did King David do when he came back and all of his men were against him and they were ready to kill him? He began to worship. He began to praise. Worship and praise is the counterattack of the enemy's discouragement. Yes. The counterattack of the enemy's condemnation. We want to fight the battle, people. We want to fight the good fight of faith. So when discouragement comes that doesn't belong to God's saints, let's begin to worship. And you might, you know, the enemy, like, you feel it when discouragement comes. You're like, you know. And the discouragement usually got there because you didn't have up the shield of faith that quenched the fiery darts. And so you let a few through and you kind of agreed with a couple. But when discouragement comes, you worship. And if it starts out with, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus. And, you know, don't let anything distract you. Your doorbell will ring. The phone will ring. Somebody will text you. There'll be an emergency. You have to just put it aside for a little bit. Because your spiritual need is more important right then because you can't be effective for anybody else if you haven't got it straight. You can't be anybody's real help. And I mean, really, in the airplane, when they tell you to put your mask on first and then put the mask on your child, if the plane was to go down and, you know, those masks, those oxygen masks drop, in case people don't fly, there's oxygen masks, and in case there's any kind of loss of pressure, these oxygen masks fall out of the ceiling, and they tell the adult, you put your mask on first, and then you help somebody next to you. If you don't have the anointing flowing in you, you can't help anybody around you because you're really, you know, in a mess and you're going to pull them down. So you have to stop what you're doing and you've got to begin to worship and praise. Yeah. Worship will counterattack the enemy's discouragement every time. And so you just break through into the worship. Yeah. And it doesn't matter if you can sing or not because the scripture tells us, he commands us to sing songs and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and exhorting one another, encouraging one another every day. So even if you can't sing, you're supposed to sing the psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Hallelujah. So you begin to thank God for what he's done. Just get so thankful that the enemy can't stand to hear you. Get so thankful. Look at what's good, not what's bad, to start with. Forget about what's bad. Forget about what's bad going on. Forget about it. Look at what's good. We have too much good to think about what's bad. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. So you know what? Joy and drawing water out of the well of salvation is when there's discouragement and the enemy's coming out against us. That's when the joy really gets good. And you know, and then we can look at the battle with Jehoshaphat. God said, send out the singers and the praisers. I'm going to fight this battle for you. This is how God fights the battle, people. You open your mouth and you begin to pray. Hallelujah. Thank you.
people, I'd like you to agree with me right now in prayer. We're reaching out for a soul. That, you know, I believe that God has been dealing with him, and it's caused things to manifest. And we're claiming the soul for the kingdom of heaven in Jesus' name. And the enemy gets his hands off in the name of Jesus. So this man can make a decision to come to Jesus, so he can see the goodness and the love of Jesus Christ. So he can make a decision to come to Jesus. And I just thank everybody right now. We're going to pray in Jesus' name. Father, we just claim the soul of Nolan Peace. Father, we bring Nolan Peace before the throne room right now. And we break the powers of darkness that would destroy his life. In the name of Jesus, we claim him in Jesus' name. We call Nolan Peace into the kingdom. We call Nolan Peace into the kingdom. Satan has to get his hands off of him in Jesus' name. We thank you, Father. We claim his soul in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father. Right now, we show that.
Thank you.
You know, people, we need to pray for one another. We need to encourage one another. We need to lift each other up. We need to realize that we're a body. We're a body. We're family. We're brothers. We're sisters. We need to make sure that we're, you know, coming around each other, not going, oh, well, I hardly know that person, and I didn't, you know. I mean, look, if somebody's going through a battle and you know it, like, come around them. Come around them. Not just at church. I mean, that'd be the last part. Come around them when they're not at church. Be a strength to them in between services. Encourage one another. Thank you, Jesus. You know what? You know, we pray prayers, and then the enemy tries to look for ways to hinder the prayer. You know, and if he can get us off track some way to get an open door, to hinder, to bring in a hindrance, he will. I mean, and the scripture, you know, talks about, you know, the husband and wife, and the husband recognizing the wife as a weaker vessel, and, you know, walking in that peace and unity basically is what the scripture is talking about. So your prayers aren't hindered. You can have your prayers hindered. You don't want your prayers hindered. You don't want to pray a prayer and then open the door to the enemy wide open so he can just sit there and go boop, 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 boop. You know, because you got down the shield of faith. You took off the armor of righteousness. You're just not paying attention. And then you're just like, how did I get in this situation? Well, thank God you can get up. But if you want your prayers to be effectual, there's a diligence in making sure that you give no place to the enemy. Give no place to him so he can't hinder your prayers. Hallelujah. So your prayers can be effectual. You know, and I'm just gonna say this because it struck me so hard. And you know, I know it's getting late, but you know, people that need to go left. But you know, Attaboy said something the other day when I was listening to him. And it just hit me so strong. He was talking about his daughters and how he had his daughters doing some things in the ministry because they walked faithfully with God and he saw their righteousness and the fruit of their righteousness in their life. And so he allowed them, because they were true righteous women of God, to do some things in the church. And because he allowed them to do it in church, you know, of course he has as a father, he has a responsibility as a father, and he has a responsibility as a minister, allowing them to do things in the church. And so the Lord told him to go over to his house, and he needed to go talk to his daughters, and he needed to bring some corrections. So he goes over to his daughter's house, and he's sitting there, and he said, you know, you guys have been arguing. And they're like, no, Daddy, we haven't been arguing. He said, you had some strife going on. He says, they're like, no, we love each other, Daddy. You know, we haven't been loving. We don't have strife. We love each other, because they live together. They got their apartment together, and we're living together. And they're like, no, Daddy, what are you talking about? You know how much we love each other. And he goes, no, you're fighting over food. And the one says, well, she burns everything when she cooks it. And the other one said, but nothing she cooks tastes good. And he said, see, I told you. And they go, how did you know? And see, they didn't even realize it. They didn't even connect it. But you know, that hit me so strong, is they, just a little bit of complaining, you burnt the food again. You know, and we'd pass over that like, But God said, you better go correct your daughters. Maybe people need to get a chalkboard in their house. And every time they open their mouth to complain, they put a little mark on the chalkboard. If it even sounds like a complaint, it's another mark. And at the end of the day, they back up and go, oh, God, help me. And then you really got a reason to hit your knees. Because then we hinder our prayers and we wonder why. He's called us over into this divine nature. That's what he's done for us. And he expects us to live like he told us to live. Not just look at it and read about it, preach about it, talk about it, think about it, but to live it. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.